I saw everyone raising hand very. Most of you guys use JavaScript day in, day out, right? How many of you write front end? Okay. So, React? Any other than React? Yeah? Okay. 6 or 7 or what?
7.
7. Nice.
Vue.
Vue, awesome.
Who's using Vue?
And you?
I use Vue for fun.
So let's keep this a bit interactive for get started. Okay, let's do a warm-up exercise. Mental warm-up exercise. Have you ever used Angular 1?
Angular JS.
But AngularJS is a very ambiguous term because कोई भी वर्जन पे अग्नि नहीं रहेगा, कोई भी वर्जन पे नहीं रहेगा. ओके, सो आई एम गेसिंग नन ऑफ यू हैव यूज्ड एंगुलर 1. शेम. आई फील नाउ ओल्ड. हां,
आई यूज इट वंस, लाइक
सम बिगिनर्स. सो लाइक आई रोट अ गेम इन एंगुलर 1, सो that kind of thing I wrote in Angular 1, and I was like that impressed with Angular 1. So I came from a jQuery spaghetti, jQuery background, then picked up Backbone, and I was like amazed. This is so amazing. Like I am sure again nobody has used Backbone here, but it was such an amazing times where you write your jQuery here and there. Like, as Augustine said, that you start with PHP. I started with PHP, and then you keep sprinkling jQuery here and there, and then there is this new thing called Backbone comes into picture, and it's like, hey dude, you guys are not giving enough attention to your front end. This is MVC for you. This is MVC, and this was not model view controller. This was model view collection. If you get a chance, go read about it. It's a good to understand where this whole started and then how we have progressed to this part. And then this, after writing, I wrote like a Gmail type client in Backbone, and then Angular 1 came in, and I was mind blown by how amazing it can be. How the beauty of it was that without writing JavaScript, I could have I could add interactivity with my application. For example, if I write ng model, it was called, I guess, ng model, and then I just have to say another text. This is an input and this is a text. This is ng model, and I have to just call that variable again, and it will start working without writing a single piece of JavaScript. I really like that kind of model, and I thought, okay, this is gonna revolutionize the whole front end space, and it did for a while. For a while, everyone was talking about Angular 1, and most of the people started rewriting their applications. The internet, as you know, the JavaScript community, every shiny new object, they have to move to that. Regardless of, even if the application is totally stable, if Dan Abramberg tweets today that, okay guys, this is not how I do things, no matter what happens, your code is passing, your business is going well, you have to be like, I'm not happy with this code anymore, because Dan doesn't use this in his reducer. So we are those, I'm a part of that community too. So yeah, like all the Twitter hype and everything started. Then people realized, okay, shit, Angular doesn't scale. Angular 1 doesn't scale. After like some 1,000 components or some, there was some arbitrary number, it starts failing because there is a loop implemented which is not, it has all dirty checks here and there in place. And I started feeling so bad about it that this is something, Angular gave me something which I wanted. It made me productive. But at the same time, now the community is not liking it. So how am I supposed to like it? I don't want to be that outlier or people who. So if I go in the meetup and I say I'm using Angular 1, and you're like, oh, let's not include him in the circle. So I don't want it to do that. I don't want it to be that person. And I realized, okay, I have to ditch Angular. Even though I'm really liking it, I'm rooting for it that it should work. I was following the Angular core team back then, and then React was just getting started. And Angular team, I remember watching the Angular conference when Angular 1 was a thing. And somebody in the audience asked the panelist, the Angular core team, that, hey, React has implemented virtual DOM. What do you guys think about it? And one of the core members said, hey, this is not something a framework should do. This is something the browser should be doing, not us. I was like, that makes sense. These guys know what they're doing. React will never win. And then it started catching up really well. We now see where it is right now. And sadly, I have to ditch Angular. But I was so, I was resenting React so much that I picked up Ember instead of Angular. Because of my backend background as well. So Ember, I'm sure nobody has used Ember here. Because Ember itself was very hard to use. So it took all the backend. If you ever write backend in any programming language, like if you use Flask or Django or Rails or Laravel right now. No, not Express. Express is actually Express is a bare bone framework. It doesn't enforce any opinionated concepts to you. You can just it's a framework which tells you to set up your own how you want to set up. But if you go in Rails or Django, if you don't write that controller, underscore controller, it will break. The entire thing will break. Like if you don't follow the conventions. That's how Ember was in the front end. You have to follow all the conventions they have mentioned, else it will not work at all. It will not even build. So we wrote a very, very large-scale application which was used by a lot of people, but it was a pain to keep Ember in check. It was a pain to get people ramp up on Ember. And I've given one talk also, I think here or another meetup, where I was like, okay, you guys have to move to Ember. And the first question I used to get is, what is the learning curve? And I was like, learning curve is steep. It's so steep that without an ebook or without a mentor, you won't be able to ramp up. For sure, like because I ramped up my team members, and I realized that without a mentor, it was very hard to get. It was because it is not driven by logic, but it is driven by opinion. The creator's opinions. This is how it should be done. This is how it should be done. So that's why it's very hard to pick, and the things which are hard to pick will lose the ground, and things which are easy to pick, like React, it was very easy to pick up React. The only learning curve was JSX, which was so abstracted out of you guys that you don't need to know what is going behind the scene, you just have to start writing it. But there is Babel, there is these things. It came as a package that, hey, if you want to use React, these four underneath libraries needs to be there. You have to change your workflow. And people were happy with it because it was all abstracted out. You just have to run some commands and it will be set up. So like, okay, finally I was like, I have to get into React. There is no other way, it seems. And I picked up React and I realized, okay, this is what I've been missing out. This is so amazing. This is a land where I can express my ideas, where it is so declarative. I can read a class and understand what it's doing without even compiling it, right? Things were very, this is what I call the framework's honeymoon period, right? Where you are so much into the framework that everything, what the core team does, you feel that, okay, these guys know what they're doing. So that's what it happened with me in Angular 1, then it happened with me in Ember, and it happened with me in React as well. And things were going fairly good. And until they mentioned that everything is going to be React hooks. I was like, okay, this is something I am not happy with. And what it does is, so what it started, the what the team started showing you as an example, and they said explicitly that this is how we are moving into a functional direction, not complete functional, but functional direction. I have huge respect for people who write functional code. I have really huge respect for Rakesh as well. And I like doing functional. I like doing functional programming myself. But I know my limits. I know very well that I am not a functional guy. Even I like to listen about functional programming. I like to understand how it is so meta that you can achieve a lot of things with one function, right? Which we saw. It is amazing. But I'm not the guy. I know where I stand. I want something very declarative, very easier to adapt, by my teammates. Fairly gentle learning curve, which I can learn on the go, and it has to keep things simple. That's my opinions are. That's how I pick a lot of technologies. That's why I've still not used Docker and like Kubernetes for. That's something for other topic. So what happened is, I moved out of my job and started building my own startup. And I wanted to pick technologies, but once they announced that React is going in a hooks manner, and they explicitly mentioned that you don't need to move to hooks. That's what they said, right? You don't need to move to hooks. Hooks is completely optional. And I was like, okay, let's see how this pans out. I think in 3 months or more or less, I don't have the exact timelines, the libraries I was using started breaking in React. I went there and saw the readme code, and I realized that everything is now hooks. Like, if you want to understand what is written in the readme, you have to learn hooks, because these libraries have stopped implementing class-based architecture. They've stopped moving. They've stopped writing about it. There are now blogs coming out of everywhere where why hooks are important, why you should rewrite your code in hooks. And Dan then mentioned that, hey, don't go on rewriting these things. But hey, using hooks is what I do. And people only take that part, right? Everyone in our community, including me, I just take, okay, I want to be Dan. And if this guy is doing this, let's do that. So I'm like, okay, let's not get into this whole madness. This was also my working title sometime, that X to Y in every 2 years is what happens in JavaScript community. Now Vue is coming is on the peak right now, if you go by GitHub stars, and if opinions, I don't know which what to follow, but this happens every 2 years. That at least it happened with me a lot of time. So again, as I mentioned that I'm not implying that there's something wrong with React or there's something wrong with any framework. What I'm implying is that every use case is different. I see a lot of people just pick up React just because it is the hype or it is what everyone is using it. That is good. If it fits your use case, that is good. But you have to understand that not every use case requires React level of optimizations, algorithm, and whatnot. Like React Fiber came out, and everyone was so hyped about it, so pumped about it, that now there is this priority rendering where it can understand which part of your component needs to get a higher priority based on that. And I was like, what kind of application are you building? And these guys are building just your typical CRUD application in a single page. Like, why do you even care that what kind of React fiber it is? At Facebook level, I can understand because, hey, there are like hundreds or thousands of components working together with billions of data coming in, going out of your one dashboard. But come on, you guys are writing CRUD operations and why do you even care? Like, you could have used Preact. That's why a lot of people don't even give a lot of attention to Preact, because Preact is a lightweight version of React. Even if you like the ideas of React, Preact is just same things with in a lighter manner, right? And these guys will talk about that after React Fiber will come into picture. You can shave off 12 KB, 14 KB. And then at a scale of what? 5 users, 10 users, if they are downloading what, 100 KB extra, will that ever matter to you? Of course, at Twitter or like if you are working for a unicorn startup or if you're working for a real Book My Show, I can really understand what 12 KB means to them. But come on, if you are writing a different application or for a startup which is just moving towards building their products or prototypes or moving from like a first launch, second launch, doesn't matter a lot. Like, sometimes I feel it's, so whatever I say, please take it with a grain of salt. And with my experience, this is a talk about my personal experiences and opinions. You can subscribe to it or you can reject it, totally up to you. You can use this as a promise. You can resolve to it or you can reject. Totally up to you. So sometimes I feel that, this has been over my decade of experience, that we stress about performance a lot. Like, every talk or every comment I go in and somebody writes that this is how you can improve your readability. Okay, what about performance? Dude, come on. Not everything is about performance. Unless you first reach that scale and then think about performance, I can totally understand. Okay, I have built a product in last 3-4 months, which has N+1 queries all over. I don't know if you come from, so N+1 query is with every for loop you are triggering a SQL query, that is called N+1 query, and I have N+1 queries everywhere. I wish I could show you my customers' WhatsApp message to me. Then Bilal, how this application is so fast? That's what he wrote to me. And this application now has not a million data, but somewhere in higher to on upper side of thousands. And like, and it is running on a $5 DigitalOcean machine. So performance is not something you should be worrying about immediately. Okay, what you should be worrying about is how easier it is to write, how easier it is to change whatever code you write. It can be front end, back end. How easier it is to write, how easier it is to change, how easier it is for your new joinee, the junior developer which is coming in the team, how easier it is for him or her to understand how to get started. That gives them a lot of confidence. If they are able to join the team and able to make a change which is live in production in 2 days or 1 day, imagine what kind of confidence they get and how amazing they will become, how productive they will become as a team member, right? So that is those are my concerns, those are my higher priority. So coming back to hooks, that's where I started moving towards different direction, because I see using hooks doesn't give me any advantage at this point. Whatever scale I'm working right now, it's actually hurting me because I hired couple of front-end developers which are fairly beginner level, and I want them to become a really good front-end developer. But if I give them complexity in the first month, something like hooks, I'll show you in the coming slide how difficult it is to understand the code, the written in hooks for a newbie or for someone who is writing JavaScript for a very long time but haven't got into this whole train of where we are right now. The bleeding edge is what I say. Is that a steep learning curve? So How many of you got a chance to look at hooks or fly it out, these things?
Like 2, 3, 4, 8, 5.
So you know, right, you can't write a hook inside an if. You can't write a hook, if you want your hook to be fired every time, you have to just pass a blank array. These are the things which, if you don't know, it's gonna hurt you so bad that you won't even realize that what is happening, why it is not working. Because you need to either have these rules written somewhere on the wall, so that you can, every time you write a component, initially, right, because it's a new concept, we all are ramping up, including me, right, we all are ramping up. So you need something, these kind of things written on the wall, or you, just let me complete this slide, okay. It is less declarative. I can't see the entire component and understand what is happening. Now it has broken into so much smaller functions, which makes sense in a different scale. It does make sense. But in a scale where small applications or medium applications work, I don't think it makes a lot of sense. It makes sense for a startup or a product which is very, if you're learning, I have learning projects where I'm using hooks to understand how it works internally, to just increase my knowledge of JavaScript, that makes a lot of sense. But if you are working on your own product or if you are in a smaller team, what you care about is how fast you can push your product to market, how fast you can add someone in the team and can get him started on the code base, how fast it is to change, how easy it is to change, right? So those are the things you should be thinking about rather than how to distribute your skills into smaller components. Yes?
Sorry, I don't know React much, so could you explain to me what a hook is?
Sure, I'll come to, there are other slides which will cover that.
Actually, that's the next slide.
Everyone with me so far? Any questions? Do you see better?
Yeah.
Yeah. So this is a hook. So this is a hook directly from React documentation. You have to use, if you are using a state, you have to define every state with this or an object, directly an object, which gives you two separate arguments which you can convert in a variable. And then you have to use effect, whatever that means. Then you have to say what you want to do, and then on click it just changes your this thing. Now, because this is again a very smaller example and this is not a real world example, it might look okay, but think about from a point of view where someone is joining or someone is understanding you, or someone is not, who is very trained to look at this kind of code, it is not very obvious what is happening here.
Is this like lifecycle hooks in
Angular? So exactly. So lifecycle hooks, what React did is all the lifecycle hooks, it converted into a smaller function, which is called use effect. So like component did mount and component did update, I guess. So now each time this variable count, set count updates, this updates the count and this function will be triggered, right? So again, it's not very easy to understand going this way.
Was there a particular reason for shifting this instead of component did mount using, instead of using component did update, using use effect?
Right. So I don't exactly remember what they said. I watched the whole React conference where this happened. I think what they said is they are moving into more, they want to get rid of this whole mental model of building a class. and then they want to move towards more functional way of doing things. Apparently that is also easier using this syntax, the functional syntax. It is easier for React to make it more optimized decision, like how they did with component will mount. Like they deprecated it and it made Fiber more easier for them to build. Yeah.
Sorry, but in the next talk, I'll be talking about a little bit about React hooks, because I'm going to be building an app with React. So, you know, I can address a lot of such questions.
Sure.
If you want, about React hooks, like why did they take this decision?
Sure. So I think this is a great setup where, you need to understand two sides of the story.
Yeah.
There is someone who has to criticize and there is someone who has to defend. It has to work like that. Seriously. I don't know what is funny about it, but it has to work like that. Because you don't buy a single, in everything, generally in life, don't buy a single argument. Always have a both arguments in place and then make your senior decision. So this is usually what hooks looks like. So let's look into a real world example, real world scenario. I created two applications where using hook, React and hooks, and one using Vue and Vue template. Does someone know how to get rid of this browser view? No.
I think so. You can also make your background white. That'll be more legible for people.
Oh, is it? This is not visible? Is this visible enough?
Yeah, no.
Better?
So black is good for when you come from.
Yeah.
You're using okay, VS Code, yeah,
no? I'm using directly Code Sandbox.
Code Sandbox is actually a version of VS Code, no?
Yeah, it has a VS Code, but I'm not very good with that.
Okay.
I used it just to do things. So, here what I built is, everyone, this code is visible, right?
Yeah.
So, this is someone else's code, so I will not say what I did. What this guy did, I created a Vue version of it. So, that's where I will say what I did. So, what this code is doing is, you have to import your hooks, and then it created something called to give you a background, this is, it makes an API call, fetches some data and gives you a cancelable fetch. You can cancel the API request if you want. Okay, so first this is the app code for it. Function app. Then it calls something called use HTTP, which is apparently your where the API call happens. This is some placeholder API provider. And if an error, then it is showing an error. If there is no data, then it is showing loading. And regardless of that, it is just rendering the list. Right? Fairly easy. This part is fairly easy. Now we go into what is inside use HTTP. So first let's get the set state and then data out of it. Then again we get another state for error. This is for data, this is for error. Now there's something called use effect. Okay, that's it here. Now inside view effect you have the fetch part of it, which is straightforward, the fetch part with the cancelable promise. Now the interesting thing starts. Okay, now it returns a function. It returns a function and it defines this. It says this. Okay, an empty array. I have no clue, or even if I read. which Vue has, which will enable you all the testing which you get in React. So I've not yet gone there, so I've yet to experience that, but definitely there's the testing ecosystem is quite strong. Actually, now what I found is Vue ecosystem is quite strong compared to React. Based on what I'm looking for would be different, but I found it better than React at this point.
There's Vue Jest in Vue as well, and there is a package called Vue Test which is for testing in Vue Summer.
Right.
Okay, any other questions for Bilal? Cool,
awesome. You guys are doing great.
So, I mean, hopefully we've got, I think so, reduced time of 10 minutes only. So you have a bio break and take coffee and come back. Next would be Pankaj, right? Pankaj will be. Yeah, Pankaj will be. Hey, Rakesh.
Yeah.
Most of the transducers were using API transformation, right? I mean, if I'm calling in APIs, I've seen noticed that, or you have seen in other use cases.
You can do it anywhere where you end up having to do multiple iterations for a system. So that could be in whatever context. Like it could be just, you know, for example, in React, you are mapping over something to put something on the screen.
No, practically, most of the time.
No, practically, actually, in reducers is the best case for using all these things. Because reducer usually handles a lot of data changes, right? You get a data, you have to change it in a lot of ways. So that's where Lambda is used a lot, and Lambda is actually the concept he explained.
Okay, we're looking at it. So I'm just trying to see.
Any place where you're doing iteration, but you are having to do it multiple times because of the way you have written your logic, and you want to combine that into one iteration, that is when you use transformers.
So in for each.
Correct.
For each.
Correct.
Is he working
with you? No. He's joining the sort of